So hello, I'm Keiko. I think today I'm going to talk. So my talk is about how our team in SAP use variants and nested structure types to represent database entities and operations on them in a programmer-minded and type-safe way. But first, I want to talk a bit, about our team, who we are, where we are, and what we do. So we are part of SAP Innovation Center Network. Our team is called Cloud Application Development Kit for Scala. So this time today, I'm wearing our team t-shirts. And our team is located in Potsdam, which is like 1 hour or 30 minutes away from here, and Bangalore. But our ICN locations have several other places. And then our team develop a set of libraries in Scala that supports the development of applications and services within the SAP context. So this includes the backend, which connects to SAP database. It's SAP HANA database. And also, we also built front-end using Scala.js, which match with a SAP-specific UI component, which is called Fiori or UI5. And then our library uses many advanced features from Scala, using higher kind of types, implicit variants, structure types, and macros. But today, my talk will be focused on variants and structure subtyping. But I first want to say some of my teammates are here as well. And Gabriel, Gaurang, Aditya, and Vikash, I don't know, maybe they are sitting in, yes. So I think they will also be able to answer questions if you have questions to my talk. So rest of my presentation. So I will first quickly recap what the variance is, structure types, and what happened? Okay, so I'm going to talk, quickly recap what are variants, structure type, and greatest lower bound, and least upper bound. And then using these three, I will somehow try to deliver the gist of our ideas in a single file. So our file is a bit more than a single file, but so for this, I kind of summarize this in the idea. And then if I have time, I will also, to enable this, actually, so after we did everything, and we start to test, and then we discover something doesn't work. And then, so our manager said, if we cannot fix this problem, we do something else. And so we are looking, we looked into the compiler, and then to do small patch to enable to fix this problem, which is something to do with computing in a better way, greatest lower bound and least upper bound for nested structure types. I think, how much time do I have more? I forget when I started. Like, I still have 20 minutes, something. Still?
27 minutes.
Okay, good. So I think I will first quickly review the concept, then move to the Scala worksheet, so to show a bit of program how this works. So what is variance? So I take it from Scala homepage. So variance is a correlation between subtyping relationship of complex type and subtyping relationship of their component type. So I will give you the example. And also the variance has been already introduced in one of the talks. So Scala support variance annotations of type parameters of generic class. So there are basically three concepts. Covariant is with a plus A. This happens if A is a subtype of B, then FA is a subtype of FB. This is covariance. Contravariance is a dual to this. So like we have bar, so you annotate with minus, and if the B is a subtype of A, then bar A is a subtype of bar B. So subtyping relationship is flipped around. And if the neither of them, it's invariant. So this is a kind of default if you don't put any annotation to parameter. So this is basically means type but A is subtype of but B only if A, if and only if A is equal to B. because subtyping is reflexive. So I go to the example. Is it whipped? It's coming good. Is it visible or should I make it the font bigger? Okay.
You have to send this to
Scala. Maybe I will go to this, let me. I will go to presentation mode.
Yes.
This is better. Yeah. Now is it visible? So I start with variance. So my example is somehow geared towards the final example I'm going to show about the, what we do. So some of them doesn't look very kind of nice, but so it will eventually come to the, this concept. So I first define two types, types of the trait column set, and then it has a subtype name, and then name and address at one more field address, extending name. The first three, the lines until 10 is clear. And then I instantiate this name and address with Keiko from Japan and Emma from Germany. So Emma is the most popular name in German, among German girls. And then what is covariant? So covariant, as I said, covariant says, so F is covariant in parameter X. If F is A is subtype of B, implies FA is subtype of FB. So for instance, in Scala, immutable list is covariant. So therefore, if I define function which takes list of name, then I can pass. So now name of an S, so this is a list. So if I have a function which takes list of name, I can pass list of name and address. Because name and address is a subtype of name. So the subtyping is in subtyping goes to the list. This is covariant. And so I can do the same with this query. So I define here query as a covariant. So I'm there's a plus annotation. And then I have a function capitalized which takes query of name. And I can call this function. I'm not calling this function, actually. I think I can call this function with capitalize. So I can say. Good. In that it type checks. So the capitalize. So this is also said query is covariant. And now I go to contravariant. What is contravariant? So contravariant, it says that so if the fx is contravariant, this is, sorry, this is a typo. This means contravariant. Oh, there's a lot of typos. I have to fix this. So this must be minus, and this must be contravariant. Contravariant. So the it's dual. And then so like the, now I define type trait expression where the type parameter is contravariant. And this, in this case, I define function which takes expression of name and name and address, and then I can call this function with the type parameter instantiated name. So subtyping relation is swapped. And then here, it is interesting, so whether parameter can be covariant parameter or contravariant parameter actually depends on where the type parameter can occur. Oops. So in this case, so I think this was already explained in the earlier talks. So like the, so it, often in technical term, it's called negative positions and the positive positions. So in the sense, like in this case, so the in, it when it occurs in a like function argument position, then this must be negative. And then in like the producer position in the query, and then this becomes covariant. And if you try to combine the both, here, it doesn't go. It doesn't. I cannot make. Oops. Okay. So if I extend from both, then it becomes invariant because it has to be both covariant and contravariant. Next, I go on. Next is structure types. This is a bit more intuitive. So what are structure types? The structure types for subtyping relation is determined by their structure. So basically, it's a kind of set inclusion of method. Now I have to view, exit presentation mode, structure, and then view, enter presentation mode. Good. So I have the same kind of types, but now I'm not using inheritance, but here I'm using structural refinement type. I forgot how it's called in Scala. So structural types. So now, so there's a name which extend the column set with method name age, extend the column set, adding method age, address has address, and then we have some. We take sum. So name and address is a name and address. Is it clear? And then structural subtyping says, here, so this says, name is a subtype of name and address. You don't have to declare a priori that name and address is a subtype of name. There's no inheritance involved. So this is a structural subtyping because name and address has more method than name, which is inheriting from column set. So the they become subtyping. So this is a status. So name is a subtype of name and name and age is a subtype of name. And if you have name, address, and age, then it will be a subtype of name and age. And then this subtyping structural subtypes extend to nested structure. So here I have a bit more detailed information of person. So now this person location has a method called person, which is again structural types. So person has name, location as country. And then I have more detailed person location information, where person has a name and age. Location is a country and there is more language field. And then subtyping again works. So now it says detailed person and location, they have more method. Even it's more nested, but the other set is this is superset of person and location. Then the subtyping works. So this is about structural types. And then last bit of the greatest lower bound and least upper bound. And I think so. I will come to the example. So greatest lower bound is of type A and B is a type C, which is a subtype of, so C must be subtype of A and B, and whenever there is a type C prime, which is a subtype of both A and B, then C is a supertype of C prime. Maybe I will skip this definition. So I just instantiated this in the case of structural types. This is what we do. So in the context of structural types, so least upper bound of structural type A and B is basically intersection, because it has less, so it has an intersection. And then the greatest lower bound becomes a union. So therefore, if I have a type, name and address, which has name and address and name and age, then least upper bound is intersection, which only have name. And then greatest lower bound is union, so they must have everything. Good. So I do the example again. Here is the example. I could use presentation mode. And the presentation mode. I wonder if I can change the code. So I repeat the same kind of type definitions are now all the same. So I think by now, I hope it's getting familiar, so that we have name and age and address, and so there's some union of them, name and address, and so. And therefore, so therefore expression, so I again use contravariance. And then, so now here, what is interesting is the line 17, the GLB, this greatest lower bound. So GLB takes two expressions, and then here, where the computation, where the Scala C compute greatest lower bound of CS and CS. So this somehow, if you're not familiar with, I think so it will take some time to figure out why this is like that. But I think so my file will be available. So if you declare a parameter to be contravariant, then, oops. Contravariant, then it will be, so if you have two of them, it will compute greatest lower bound. We can see this. So here in line 18, I'm taking greatest lower bound and name and age and name and address. And if I take look at what it's returned is that it's a name and address and age. So it's computing the union. And this is what type system does. And then if you want to compute least upper bound, you use covariant in query. And in this case, and then we take two queries, and then this will compute least upper bound. So least upper bound is the intersection. And we can see this, if you call this function, least upper bound, name and age, and name and address, then what we get? So here, you see, there is only name and string. So Scala will compute intersection. So this is all the idea that we are using. There are many other things, but it's one aspect of the technology we are using in our team. And then I come to what we are doing, how we are using this concretely to represent database object in Scala. So this is a data layer for our cloud application development kit for Scala. And we put everything together with a but with Akabit, actually, we are also doing macros. But in this talk, I kind of avoid macros. So I have some small example. And then I also want to make a historical note. So the idea of using structure types to represent database objects is actually old idea. So it goes back to the late 90s. So there are several papers along this idea on how to enable type inference for structure types in the context of ML programming language. So, I think I have to be very quick. Maybe I just try to say so what we do is that so we again have similar types. So column set. This column set represent what kind of columns each, like the table in data set. So what kind of columns, tables in database have. And then, so many of the boilerplate code is, so we are producing many these boilerplate type definitions from a schema in database. So this is one aspect, how we use macro. But here I write everything manually. And then, so normally, so, oops. So for the each column set, so we have the representation of columns in table. But what is important is that so we have some, yes, what is the type part is important. So in this talk, we assume there are four columns, which is like so name, address, age, and premium. And they have a type parameter here, column set premium. So they somehow say what is their name and what is their type. So this is how we represent columns in Scala. And then I skip. And then, so there will be expression type. And then this is contravariant. So we define expression contravariant. This means, so this, and then we use type parameter CS to keep track of columns used in the expression. And then by making this contravariant, so the types, whenever you use several expressions, the type system will compute union of columns that is used expression. So we are using computation of greatest lower bound for keeping track of columns and to accumulating this information using Scala compiler, Scala type checker. And then for the queries. So for query, the query is like representation of a table. Here we use covariant type parameter CS. And then this is because, so if query, so if the table provide column ABC, it's okay to assume it only, if the function says, I need a query which provides column ABC, it's okay to pass query which contains ABC and D. So this is how that it matches. So as a producer, it is covariant. And the expression is using, expression is consuming column definition. Expression is consuming column, so it's contravariant. And then so we define some operations on queries, like where. So where will add some condition on query. And then here, you see query. So it has query and expression. And they somehow, the columns they provide have to match. So then I can write something like the where. So you have a query which has name and age. And then I can say the column depth of age must be 90. So I'm looking for the person who is 90 years old. And then, but the slight problem occurs when we try to join two tables. So basically joining two tables is just combining two tables. And then now, it's okay. I can perfectly take union of name and age and premium. Then just we take the union of that both columns. But what we will do, what we should do, is that we try to take join of two tables where the column name clashes. Like so, I want to take a join of table which contains name and age and name and address. Then if we only have the flat namespace, it's problem because we don't know which. And this is where so we introduce nesting. So we introduce. Like so add notation, so add is making alias. But this is so I look at the type. So this adds A will take a column set of CS and pack it under name A. So normally adds is implemented in macro to turn string to type name, to string to this nesting of A or B. So here just I have a two instance of as A and as B. But basically, as A packs everything that query have under name A. And this as B will pack everything query has, CS, to under the name B. Mm-hmm. So as a result, I can just join. I can join name and age and name and address under the name of as A and as B. So they will be now packed into under the name of A dot something and B dot something. And then I can join them, and then I can also write conditions size, like saying, so I want to only have rows where the name of from table A is equal to name from table B. So this is somehow, so we believe this is a kind of programmer friendly way because we are familiar with namespace. And then somehow in this way, we can have more precisely defined kind of meaning of names. I think this is most of the end of my talk. I think I will just quickly. So unfortunately, so this program compile here. However, if I do, it doesn't compile with Scala compiler. What is it do? So if I try to compile, it doesn't work. And this is where the compiler patch just comes from. So actually, the current Scala compiler has limitations for supporting computing GLB and LUB for nested structural types. So we patch the compiler and we have pull request. And then so our patch allows the compiler to compute greatest lower bound and the least upper bound for structural types of nesting depths at most some N. And this N is somehow hard-coded in the source code. This is a bit kind of unfortunate thing. And then when we do this, so this is, we fix the recursion depths by having somehow maximum number of recursion in the type checking. And so why originally the compiler has a recursion limit of recursion depth zero. And this was why there was the nesting level was limited to one. And for us, we pragmatically fixed nesting level of maybe 8 or something. So 8 is arbitrarily chosen. And yes, this is the end of my talk. So I just quickly summarize. So I recapped what is the variance is, nested structure type. Also, I talked about GLB, LUB, LUB. And then I summarized how we use this idea in our application. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any questions?
So it looks like you're querying just tables, and there are some existing solutions like Slick and Quill for creating SQL queries with Scala DSL.
I think it's quite similar what we are doing. So I think that's so. Actually, I don't think that's really I think that's maybe the technology we are using. So I think that our work is a bit inspired by links, Microsoft links. But so it's more integrated to the SAP component. So it has to be fast, it has to be JVM. It's kind of, this is somehow.
Okay. And so you're building your solution for querying.
Including UI solutions, yes.
Okay, any more questions?
Thanks for the talk. Just as a follow-up kind of to the previous question, what's the, so Slick, I mean, it doesn't use structural types typically. You use kind of nominal types and use structural types for database stuff here. So is there a specific like advantage of using structural types to represent?
I think in a structural type, so
schemas rather than nominal types? Because typically in SQL, you also have kind of these nominal
types. I think that's so why we use structural type. This is because we want to define functions. Like, so now, so there is no need to define kind of, so we don't need to declare what is subtype of what a priori. So that kind of subtyping relation is automatically derived. So there is no need to declare what is the entire set of columns. So there can be like the function. So here, this name is, and this take query. So this name is takes query, which contains at least column name. And then everything, any query that contains method name can be called together with this function name is. And this is where structural types is useful. Because so you don't have to declare a priori something is subtype of name. And this kind of polymorphism is, so I don't know how.
that makes sense.
Okay, another question somewhere? Are you all ready for lunch? Okay, then let's thank Keiko again.